Hello, Forecaster here again, and we are back for episode 50 of the Railcraft server Let's Play. And I didn't really need to do anything to get the program to work. Not sure what was happening, I just restarted everything and it seemed to work correctly. As you can see, we are on the server right now. And I want to start setting things up a bit. Not sure how far we will get. And hopefully we'll get to a point where we can actually install the program. So I've made some things. I don't have all the components quite yet, but I'm relatively close. It seems snow doesn't form on slabs, even if they are flush against the ground like this. I guess it doesn't form on any opaque blocks. Or transparent blocks, I mean. Even if they are technically a solid surface upwards. Anyway, let's ride down. I actually had to reboot that computer up there. It had shut down for some reason, and the screen was frozen. The bottom one and the server itself were fine then. Oh, I guess it is a bit dark down here. Come on. There we go. Oh geez, that's pretty dark, yeah. Whoops. As you can see, I have made a computer. I decided that because servers are pretty expensive, that I would have a computer run the server or the reactor here instead. It doesn't really matter all that much, and I realized that I don't have the EEP ROM with the BIOS on it, so we can't actually run this thing. But that's not really why we're here at the moment. I also realized I didn't bring the pipes. But as you can see, I've made the other things. I also don't have any tanks. I'm missing a lot of things. But we are going to have the output here. It's going to come in here. And it is going to split between these two liquid heat exchangers. I also don't have the what are they called? The things that transfer the heat conductors. I'm gonna need a lot of those for these two, I think. Yeah, 10 per heat exchanger, so 20 in total. They're not hard to make, fortunately. They're just some copper and rubber, which is fine. Then the steam boiler goes in the middle, and let's see. I have gotten the number. I guess we'll set that up later. Then we're just going to put two steam turbines on top, and I probably want that facing this sort of way, like that. And I'll have to move this torch I pretty much just placed. I'll put it there, I guess. And then we're going to want two kinetic generators and turn them around so they're facing the steam turbines. And then the condenser is going to go next to the top steam turbine. And Actually, let's pop all of this again and I want to place it a bit higher up. And I'm going to pop upstairs and let's run back to the old base for a bit. We need some pipes. So we're going to make some pipes. And I think I have some somewhere. Question is where I put them. There's some. I may have more. Come on. Those are energy pipes. That's not gonna do it. No. And no. Okay. Okay, I guess I don't have any other pipes. Twenty-one is probably not going to do it. We may need more than that, so let's grab some copper, some clay, and I'm pretty sure this thing is powered. So we should just be able to turn that on and put those in there. Some copper plates, and then we should be able to put those in there to get some copper sheets like that. And it's the game's being a bit laggy. Not entirely sure why. And that should give me two stacks of pipes, which should be plenty, plus the 21 I already had. Okay. I'm also going to grab one of these bat boxes, which has some power. Actually, let's grab both of them. To get charge up the computer a bit for later use. Actually, or wait, no. We'll do that later if there is time, otherwise, we'll do it in the next episode. I was thinking I was going to download the program onto the disk, but I may want to go over it one more time and make sure I don't want to change anything right now. It should be good to go. I'm pretty sure it's done for the most part, at least. There's actually, whoops. There's that lag again. There's actually one. Oh, jeez, it's dark in there. I completely forgot I had my night vision turned off. So used to having it. Okay, let's put a bat box there for now. And then put another one there. I'll dump this one into this one if need be. Gets us. Oh yeah, we'll need the EDP ROM as well. Okay, so we're going to have a tank right here. And I don't think we need one there. But the pipe is going to sit here. And I'm actually going to clear this out. Because it's in the way. And I'm going to fill it in with reinforced stone. Put a reinforced stone wall here later on to be safe. Because while the current configuration doesn't breach the reactor chamber when it or if it blows up, maybe I want to use a configuration that will do that in the future. So we'll build it to last, I guess. I also just realized that I don't have a tablet in this on the server, so you're gonna have to make one of those, and I don't have the components for that. I used all of my circuit boards I had so far. It takes a lot of those, so I'm going to have to gather some materials. So we'll probably have to do that in the next episode. What I'll probably do is we'll do some more work here, and then we'll pop back into the test world and look at the program some more. I have at least one change that I do want to make, which is relatively minor, but yeah. Actually, maybe I want the pipes to go down into the floor and then over to, say, probably at least here. So that I can have them go beneath the reinforced stone wall. So that is that. Let's expand a little bit more. So we're going to have the heat exchangers like that. And then we're going to have the steam boiler in the middle. And I guess they can be like that so that they aren't in the way too much. And then on this side, we're going to have it output, and we're going to need the two buffer tanks here and here. But then below here, we can have the pipe. So it's going to be tank, then pipe. And I was right, we did need more pipe. And then we can just have a lever here powering these two pipes, although that might power that one as well, which I don't want. So let's go down one more. And then maybe what I could do, actually, we're going to need to be kind of there. So we're going to do like this. Let's dig in this direction until we encounter the setup I just built. There it is. So here's the exit or return pipe. Pretty perfect, if I do say so myself. And that should be able to go directly in there. We don't need anything there, I don't think. And then, of course, the steam turbines go on top like that. Condenser goes there. And then the kinetic generator there. And I'm going to clear this out, construct the room a bit, sculpt the room, perhaps. A little bit more off-camera, probably. So that'll be done, or semi-done in the... It'll be more done in the next episode, hopefully. Also need to make the actual turbines, which is going to take a lot of steel. Need to make the EEPROM for this. I do have most of the other equipment. So we have the redstone IO block. I have two adapters. And I need to make a bunch of cables. I also have four transposers because you make them in fours. We only need one, of course. I don't have... two redstone ports. Need to make another redstone port. Because one is going to have an adapter on it, so we can read the heat level of the reactor and such. The other is going to have a redstone IO block on it, of course, so that we can control the reactor. So I'll do it for here. So I'll be right back. I'll switch to the creative world with the reactor in it. All right. So here we are in the all too familiar test world because we've spent the last like three episodes in here, I think. Maybe even four. And I set this up. So, of course, the a tablet is pretty much a portable computer. It's a handheld computer. Behaves exactly the same as a computer with a tier 2 screen and a tier 2 graphics card in it. At least the tier 2 tablet does. And I set this creative computer up and I put the program on it, the client, and as you can see, it works just like it does on the tablet, like I just said. And the override is currently enabled. As you can see, the button is green. There's a keyboard on top, so if we click the screen, we get the interface, and we can either hold shift and right click the screen directly, and we can toggle the override. And the fluid level is maxed out. Is this not running? This is not running. That is a bit weird. Let's discharge the power completely and we'll see that the power level is now 0%. Another thing I want to do is to move these percentage readouts to above or next to each label for the bars, because it's kind of unnecessary to have them separated. Maybe I'll have the raw numbers here or something. So why isn't the... It claims the override is enabled, which it shouldn't be. This was working the last time. Okay, so something is wrong with the state there. It says the override is enabled when it isn't. So it's not setting it properly, which is odd, to say the least. Okay, let's have a poke over here. Now, someone pointed out that the text was kind of blurry on YouTube, and I think I fixed that. Initially, I assumed that it was YouTube's compression that did it, but I was shown an example multiple times, which was kind of unnecessary, but still an example of text that was in IntelliJ, even from IntelliJ. That was nice and crisp. So hopefully I adjusted OBS appropriately to fix that. I guess we'll see when the video goes up. And this will be a bit more readable. It was kind of readable before, but if it's easier to read, that is, of course, desirable. And also, I should point out that I've put the put links to the repository where I upload all of this code, Git repository, hosted on a GitLab server, for everyone to access. And I've put links to that in all of the videos where I've been working on this, which I kind of forgot initially, unsurprisingly. Okay, so let's have a look over on the code once more. So something weird is going on with the override state on the server. So we have the set state function. So I'm setting state. Yeah. Wait, that's not the override. The override is controlled by this. And it's completely controlled by the by the network message. It's not set anywhere else. So the problem has to lie in the client then. So here we have this. Yeah. So if override state is true, we set it to false. Otherwise, we set it to true. So this basically inverts the state, which should be correct. So this should be red and this is green. And then after we've set it, we broadcast on the server port the new state. So I'm not sure why that wouldn't work. That should work, right? That's pretty strange, I have to say. If we pop back into Minecraft, as soon as the override disengages properly, the reactor should start running. We can reboot this. and see if that does anything. Reactor manager run. So this should update. Is this? Yeah, so that is running now. I should probably also have an indicator for the fluid output state, because those two are kind of separate. Oh, jeez, that's a bunch of moving in and out. Being precise in Minecraft can sometimes be difficult. So it's definitely running now. Override is off, so let's turn that on. Override engaged, and then it prints enabled. Why does it print engaged twice, though? It should only receive that once, right? That's peculiar. But now it's stopped everything. This is cooling back down. The reactor is being kept from running, and it's not outputting any fluid. Now if we disengage, and now it works. But it printed disengaged twice as well. That's very odd. So why? Because we definitely only have the one broadcast. And we definitely only have the one touch event, right? I mean, if I reboot this, just to clear any listeners, and then we'll run the reactor client again. Now, if we look here, it still runs that code twice. But it is now working. I wonder if it breaks when the server restarts, the world server, or when they unload and load. Although that should correct itself, you would think. This is very odd. Very odd indeed. Because we're not doing anything strange anywhere. So we're sending the new override state to the server, and then the server will respond with an update once pinged by the client again, and it will get the state back. But we're only sending it once, so why is the server receiving it twice? Because basically this runs twice. And this will only run when we receive a broadcast with an override packet. I am quite perplexed why this is happening. Because as far as I can tell, it shouldn't. This is very odd. But it sort of works, I guess. Now, here, I want to move these. So these are the percentage values. Basically, we're going to append them to here instead. So we're pretty much going to take that and that and apply to here. And then, oh, I copied them. I meant to cut them, but whatever. Here, do I? I actually don't send the raw numbers, do I? I calculate the percentages here. I guess we don't really need them. Yeah, I think the raw numbers are probably largely inconsequential or unnecessary. Running out of time, I notice. So the reactor state. Let's make a new variable called fluid state, not state. State. I'll initialize it as false. And we're going to send that as well. So fluid state equals fluid state. Sending the states, and that will be sent with the data to the client. Now, when the pipe control is so this is the thing I was talking about. Vexitus pointed out that you're supposed to have local functions as well, generally. And I kind of forgot about that. They kind of work the same as variables. So you want local function and not just function, because those are global functions. And having things global, unless you know exactly what you're doing that for, is bad. So set pipe state to state. So we're going to want to do this. We're going to have this. So if state, then do that and set the I call it fluid state. Let's call it pipe state instead. Let's do a replace on that. And then rename that as well. Call it pipe state equals state. I guess I can do that outside of the if statement, and if pipe state is true, we want it to be on, so 15, and if it's false, we want the pipe to be turned off. And then we're going to replace this with set pipe state true. Actually, that was false, wasn't it? And then set pipe state, that should be true. Remove that. And then set pipe state false. Remove that. And then we have one there, although it's set shut down, so it doesn't really matter all that much, but we might as well use the function we made. So now we have a true false state for the pipe as well. So we can here which we will receive from the server. So here we need to also make a local pipe state, which is false. And then here we're going to receive that as well. And then here we can basically copy this setup. We'll call it, label it fluid state, actually fluid output state, and we'll say pipe state, of course. And then we need to adjust these, so we need to move them down. So four, and because fluid output state, how much longer is that? It's about there. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we need to add 6 to these, which say what exactly? That says 18. I wasn't sure it's if it said 10 or 8 or 10 or 18. So if we make these 24, should be fine. Then we're going to pop back into Minecraft. I'm going to reboot this. Thought I set that up to upload to this computer as well, but I guess we'll boot up the tablet quickly. And there we go. That's a little off. Looks like I put too much in there. Things are running though. That doesn't actually seem to be. Oh yeah. Need to reboot the server program as well, so it actually sends the fluid state. And I'm going to have to end the episode here because I think we're almost 40 minutes. We're almost at 40 minutes. But we've done some work. I didn't actually replace all of the, or put local before all of the functions, but I'll do that before I push these changes into the repository, so they will be there when this video goes up, by for sure. And in the next one, we'll be back on the server. Hopefully I'll have scrunched some of the other stuff together and we'll be able to continue setting stuff up. And hi, we'll see you then.